Gospel of Luke, chapter 9. We'll begin this morning in verse 57. And again, want to welcome all of you to the house of the Lord. Want to welcome our visitors, and we want to welcome those that are watching us on live stream. And again, we just pray that God give you your portion this morning in Christ. And we're just believing God for a good time in His Word here. Luke chapter 9, beginning in verse 57. And it says, "And it came to pass that as they went in the way, a certain man said unto him, Lord, I will follow you whithersoever you go. And Jesus said unto him, He said, the foxes have holes, the birds of the air have their nests, but the Son of Man has no place to lay his head." But Jesus is telling these people in a quick decision are saying, Lord, I'm going to go with you. I'll do your will. I'll follow you. I just want to be where you are, Lord. And Jesus, instead of just jumping on their enthusiasm and said, well, sure, come on. There's room in the ark for you. Let's go. He kind of tests their heart. The same Jesus, let's put it this way, Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He still tests our hearts. Amen? This man says, Lord, I will follow you wherever you go. And Jesus said, the foxes have holes, birds of the air have their nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. Then another said unto him, and he said unto another, follow me. But he said, Lord, allow me first to go home and bury my father. In other words, I got obligations. I got to take care of the family farm and the family business. I'm his right hand. Once Dad passes on and I get some things in order, then I'll follow you then. I'll have time. See, that's kind of where that's going. Then Jesus said unto him, and it seems like strong language, but he says, let the dead bury their dead, but you go and preach the kingdom of God. Obviously, this individual had a call to preach and was ignoring the call, was trying to fulfill the call in a convenient season, at least when it appeared to be convenient for him. As we move on here a little bit, in verse 61, and another also said, Lord, I will follow you, but first let me go bid them farewell which are home at my house. In other words, I got family ties, family obligations. My family is very, very important to me, and that's a right thing. But he was putting that ahead of his relationship with Jesus Christ. And Jesus said unto him, no man, having put his hand to the plow, looking back, is fit for the kingdom of God. Jesus gave some very peculiar answers to people that meant well. These weren't evil men trying to just get out of an obligation. These were sincere people that said, Lord, I do want to follow you. I do want your will. I do want. But then when Jesus would say, okay, but this is the cost, all of a sudden now we got a conflict here. You see, that's where this is going. Amen. Now, go to verse 23. Back to verse 23, I should say. Same chapter. And he said unto them all, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross every day and follow me. For whosoever will save his life will lose it. But whosoever will lose his life for my sake, the same will save it. For what is a man advantage if he gain the whole world and lose himself or be cast away? For whosoever shall be ashamed of me and of my words, of him shall the Son of Man be ashamed when he shall come in his own glory and in his Father's and of the holy angels. This morning's message, we're going to continue our mini-series, Jesus, the Bread of Life, Part 3. Jesus, the Bread of Life, Part 3. This whole series started out, I know last week we tried to just kind of go through a little bit, but we got to keep building upon a foundation that we laid a couple weeks ago. But Jesus, out of John chapter 6, began to make some very strong claims to his hearers, those who were pondering, do we follow him? Is this one really the Messiah? Is this one really God in the flesh, or is he an imposter? And as Christ was preaching to his disciples and those that were following him at that time, Jesus began to make some very, very powerful statements about himself. He would start telling those people by the multitude there that I am the bread of life. In other words, he's saying that your sustenance, your spiritual life, your vitality comes from me. And then he would expound on that a little bit, and he would say, go on to tell these people. Now remember, not everybody listening to him is convinced that he's the Messiah. And so you got Jesus, the carpenter's son. Amen. That's kind of who he was to those that knew him and knew of his background. We got Jesus, the carpenter now. He was the son of Joseph, and now he's going around as a rabbi. He's going around preaching and teaching. And as he's teaching, he starts making claims of himself that was very difficult for the hearers of that time to handle. Things like, I am the bread of life. Without me, ye can do nothing. He will go on to say, unless you eat of my flesh and drink of my blood, you don't have no life in you. And so what he was saying was that, in other words, your life source has to come from me. And I'm paraphrasing a little bit, but what he was saying is that I am the Son of God. I am the Messiah. That's what Jesus was saying. He was telling that people that I am the one who was promised from the Garden of Eden. I'm here now in the flesh. I am your source of life. Now eat of me, drink of me, and you will live forever. And if you eat and drink of me, I promise you, you will never die. See? And he was making those claims. And they were right claims. I want you to know that if Jesus ever stretched the truth of anything he said, even a little bit, it would have been sin, and it would have disqualified him from being the Lamb of God, the sacrifice of God on the cross. He'd be in that tomb yet today, and you and I would be dead in our sins. So what he was saying was the truth. He would tell people at another time, I am the life, the truth, and the way. When Pilate would look at him prior to him being crucified, Pilate would ask that great question, what is truth? What is truth? He was looking at truth. Truth is a person. That person is the Lord Jesus Christ from heaven. Amen. Hallelujah. The one that lives in my heart. The one who saved me. The one who birthed me into his kingdom by my repentance towards him. Amen. And faith in him. Amen. Hallelujah. He is the bread of life. Glory to God. And what he was teaching that congregation of old was that to enjoy the life that I will provide, it's going to require your complete surrender to my lordship, my person, my work on the cross for you, and the will of God for your life. And that's really the heart of what we've been trying to bring out. We have too many people in Christendom today that don't want him as Lord. They want him as Savior, but they don't want him as Lord. And that's a dangerous place to be. Listen, we got inadequacies. We got idiosyncrasies. We're stubborn at times. We're hard-headed. Amen? We get locked up because we're human and we have emotions and we're not always in the faith. Come on. We're inconsistent many times. We're moody. We're quirky. Come on. Amen? Come on. Come on. All we got to do is ask your spouse. Amen? Come on now. But yet, he loves us. Yet he is patient with us. Yet all he asks of you is just come to me and surrender your heart and your very life to me. And let me take it up in me and my what I did for you at the cross. And now follow me. And you will live. You will live forever. And you'll never, never die. Amen. You know, in the passing of Joan last week, you know, she died, but she didn't die. Her physical body gave out, but she was just transitioned from one state to another. You know, like the message we preach at the funeral, buried or carried, she was carried by the angels into the very presence of God. And she's there yet right now, amen? Why? Because Jesus Christ was on the throne of her heart. She surrendered her life at one point in time to the lordship of Jesus Christ, and she was born again. Amen. And God provided her righteousness, and God provided her sanctification, and God, through the tree, through the cross, through the finished work, provided everything she needed to qualify her, that as she stood before the Lord, she could stand there faultless with joy, amen, before His glory. Hallelujah. Amen. Think about that. Isn't that awesome? And when it's your number and my number, and it's our turn, should the Lord tarry, He will present you and I faultless before His presence with exceeding joy and glory also. That's good news for all of us this morning. Amen. Hallelujah. Because I need all the help I can get. Amen. And so do you. So do you. Amen. Praise the Lord. So, we dealt with that about Jesus being the bread of life. And God's redemptive plan for man requires every man's personal surrender to that plan. There's only one redemptive plan for man, and that is Jesus Christ and Him crucified for you. It's that simple. Jesus and His work on the cross. Had not Jesus been crucified and He remained alive to this very hour, He really couldn't save any of us. Men would still be locked, how can I say, in paradise, which is somewhere below in the bowels of the earth. Hell was divided into two parts prior to the cross. And when the righteous dead passed on in faith that the Messiah would redeem them from their condition of sin, they went to the paradise side. But it wasn't until Jesus paid the price on the cross, paid the outstanding sin debt of man with His perfect life's blood, then He immediately went into the bowels of that place called Sheol, or not to suffer, but to prove, how can I say, but to preach His victory. Amen? And He liberated captivity captive. And He ascended on the heaven with the saints of God. Amen. So Jesus, because of the blood, because of His sacrifice, was able to liberate the paradise side of hell at that time. Amen. And now when men and women pass on with Christ in their heart, who put their faith in His shed blood, at the moment of this body given out, we are instantly in the presence of the Lord. For to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. Amen? Hallelujah. There is no soul sleep. You know, I know our Jehovah's Witness people, they claim that you just go to the grave and you just go into a sleep. And at the resurrection, God's going to resurrect everybody out of the grave, and then they're going to evaluate your works. You're going to stand on the good old meter. And you're going to, in their mind, and you're going to, if you did good enough, then you go into glory forever. If you didn't do good enough, you go back to the dust, back to the grave, and you go back into a sleep, into annihilation, and you just, you're out. That's it. It's over. Well, that's not what the Bible teaches. The Bible teaches that when we pass on, we are fully conscious, one in either place. Fully conscious. Amen. But now as we go on to heaven, we await the resurrection of the body, because one day, at one time, at the rapture of the church, all the living and all the dead in Christ will be given at one time a new glorified body. Hallelujah. And it'll probably be about 31, 2, 3 years old. Amen. That's the way it's going to look. Oh, isn't that great? Amen. No gray hairs, no wrinkles, no problems, won't be overweight, amen? I mean, think about it. You have all our hair, all our faculties, all our teeth, amen? Hallelujah. Isn't that good news? Amen. Hallelujah. That's good news. That's good news. Amen. And we'll be kept alive by the power of the Holy Spirit. We kind of talked on that a little bit Wednesday night. So, God's redemptive plan requires every man's personal surrender. It begins with a surrender of life and one's will. We see it in the scriptures with Abraham. He surrendered his father's house, his kindred, and his country. These people that we were reading about in our text today were asked of the Lord subtly to forsake something. House, occupation, family. Amen. To follow the one who was going to make all things new for them. Amen. See? What has God asked of you? What has been your surrender? Is He asking you to surrender something right now? Amen? Amen. God is after something in our heart. But then we talked about not only God's redemptive plan requires every man's personal surrender, I mean, but also the only way to God, and this is what we have to understand. Today there's such generic believism that we can believe anything and think everybody's just going to heaven because they were a little bit, they had a little bit of spirituality about them. But the Bible says very clear that there's only one way to God, and that is through the Lord Jesus Christ. For the Bible says there's one mediator between man and God, and that is the man Christ Jesus. Amen? Without your hand in His hand, you're not going to heaven. Spiritually speaking, without your hand in His hand, a surrendered life will embrace the hand of Jesus Christ, their Lord. And you will walk hand in hand with Jesus Christ all of this life. And friend, when you get to heaven, you'll grab His hand and you'll want to walk with Him forever there, in thankfulness of the great things He hath done to provide your and my salvation. Amen. Hallelujah. So understand that surrendered life is a picture story. It means that you grabbed His hand. It was an act of your will to His goodness and His love extended to you through the gospel message. You've embraced His hand. By faith, you've embraced Him. God pictures it as a union, as a marriage. I've entered into a covenant with this one called Jesus. I've surrendered my heart. I've surrendered my life. I've laid it at His feet. I've grabbed His hand. I say, now walk with me. Let me walk with you, Lord, and lead me. Wherever you go, I will follow. See? That's the picture story of what true salvation looks like. And that should be the heartthrob of every believer in Jesus Christ. He is my bread of life. I do eat of His flesh. I do drink of His blood. My nourishment, my spiritual vitality, my spiritual life, it comes from Him. And what He did on the cross for me. See, that's why in our text, we read that portion where Jesus said, every day now, he that will follow after me, let him take up his cross daily. Daily, daily, daily. Amen. Those of you that struggle with the message of the cross, you argue with Jesus. Don't argue with me. Argue with Him. He said every day. And that means take up by faith what He did for you at the tree as a benefit package. And enjoy life. And enjoy Him. And live for Him. Live from Him. Walk with Him. So, the only way to God is through Jesus Christ. And we talked about this. And the only way to Jesus Christ is through His cross. That's the only way. There's many Jesuses that are preached today. Paul even said it in the Corinthian letter. They preach a different Jesus that we have not preached. It's empowered, that message is empowered by a different spirit that gives it power and validity in the hearts and minds of those that believe the lie, that are believing on the imposter. I'm here to say there's a Jesus. There's many Jesuses today being preached in many churches around this nation and around this world. But the one we're preaching is the one who said, I am the bread of life. The one who died for your sin. The one who said, take up my cross, take up your cross. Follow me every day. Lay your life down. Abandon yourself to me. And I will take up your life and make something beautiful out of it. Amen? Hallelujah. That's good news. That's the one we preach. The one of the Scriptures. The Christ of the Bible. There is only one. There's a Christ of the denominational world that turns Him and His work on the cross into a sacrament. It brings salvation by works. Because you need a preacher to administer their ritual of baptism. They prove it by giving you the scripture and or the certificate. Amen. They take the pictures and everybody gloats over you and you go out and have a dinner and say, he's a child of God because we baptize him as a baby. That's a different Jesus. That's a different way of salvation. There's been no repentance in that heart. There's no free will believing on Jesus Christ. It's been imposed upon them, and it takes a minister to perform the act. We even pick that up in the Pentecostal world, in the United Pentecostal movement. They say if you're not baptized according to the proper formula, if you don't say it just right, if you don't baptize in Jesus' name only, even though Jesus is the one who said baptizing them in the name of the Father, number one, the Son, number two, and of the Holy Ghost, number three. The Godhead three in one. It's not about a formula. Then that makes it a work, and it makes it dependent on that work. It's a lie from the pit of hell for men to control men. It's the practice of the Nicolaitans, of which Jesus said, I hate that. I hate it when preachers and religious authority lords it over the laity, the body of Christ. Amen. My friend, there's liberty in Christ. There's liberty in the gospel. There's liberty in the Word of God. Amen. Pastor, don't you have authority as a minister of God? Yes, I do, and that's to preach you the truth and to preach the Word of God to you. And I have authority to make sure this service is run according to the work of the Holy Spirit and the Word of God, and we keep divine order that way. But once you leave this place, I don't chase you down. Amen. You belong to Christ here and out there. Amen. So think about it. We come to Christ because He's the only mediator. But the only way to Christ, we got to come through His cross. And this is what He's showing in Luke 9. He's talking to people. People want to follow Him. People have a sincere desire. And He starts dealing with their heart, their motives. You really want to follow me? You really want to come to me? You really want what I can provide for you? It's going to cost you everything. You will have to abandon yourself to my will. Amen. And you're going to need to take up your cross every day. And I want you to follow me. Follow me. Why follow me? Because I'm the bread of life. I am your source of life. You can't have life without me. Without your hand in my hand, you're not going to get out of this life alive. That's a term that I don't know where it came from. I think that came into my spirit one day, but I use that because it strikes home. How do we get out of this life alive? By faith, your hand is in the hand of the one who died for you to get you out of this life alive. He's a Savior. A Savior. He saved you. It implies you have been rescued from impending doom. Amen? You have been, and not only that, not only did He rescue you, but He purchased for you everything you need to be qualified as perfect to go to heaven. Amen? See, this is why we got to sort this out. I pray we're believing on the right Jesus, and I pray we're believing on the right gospel, and I pray, and the right gospel will produce the fruit it says it will. It will produce the fruit of the Spirit in your heart and in your life. Amen? Now, I want to get into this. First of all, let's look at this now. The only way to Jesus Christ is through the cross. Paul would even say, I'm crucified with Him, but nevertheless, I'm living, yet not I, but it's Christ that's living in me, and the life that I'm now living in the flesh, I'm living by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave Himself for me. You see, every one of us, as we become a little more knowledgeable in the finished work of the cross, that should be your confession too. That's not just Paul's confession. That's just not a cute little scripture we can put on the refrigerator. Oh, isn't that nice? I'm crucified with Him. Oh, I'm buried with Him. Oh, I'm risen with Him. Isn't that sweet? I just love that scripture. You know, no. There's a truth there that Paul found. He said, this is the heart of the new covenant. This is why He died. This is what He did for us. Amen. And as I'm learning and understanding my relationship with God is through the cross and through that work of the cross that Jesus did on my behalf, then I am fully provided for and deemed as perfect in the eyes of God my Father by my union with the Son of God, Jesus Christ. See? Amen. Hallelujah. Okay, now that I got your attention. Amen. The resurrection life, we hear a lot about that, cannot be fully realized until the life is first surrendered to God's redemption plan, the cross. I'm going to read this one more time. You and I, we all want resurrection life. The work of the cross, properly believed upon, Jesus in Him crucified, will produce the resurrection life in you. Amen. Freely given. You just got to properly believe. Believe on the proper truth. Amen. You got to properly be anchored in Christ and understand that His death was to provide for you a perfection that will not only bless you in this life, but it'll carry you into the next life. Intact, whole, and blameless. Amen? Isn't that good news? So, listen to these scriptures. The resurrection life cannot be fully realized until the life is first surrendered to God's redemption plan, meaning the cross. Paul would say it this way in Romans 6. Now, if we be dead with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with Him. Listen to his language. He's talking about this resurrection life, how the victory of the cross provides everything we need and the victory over sin. Amen. The victory over our sin nature. This is what Paul is dealing with, and this is how he talks to the Roman church 2,000 years ago. He's telling the Roman church, if you be dead with Christ, we believe that you shall also live with Him. He's telling that congregation, if you be dead with Him. It's kind of what we're talking about here today. An abandoned life. I've surrendered my life. That means to be dead to something. To be dead to something isn't a physical death necessarily. To be dead to something means that there's no relationship with this thing no more. It's a dead thing. Amen. Amen. It's like you had high school buddies, but you drifted apart, you just went each other's way. When you were in high school, I mean, you guys were inseparable, but now you kind of went your own way, and even though that's out there, you're dead to it. There's no relationship, no communication. I know that's out there, it's living out there, but I'm dead to it. That's what he means, if we be dead. That's what he's talking about, dead to my old life, dead to my sin nature, dead to what I used to be, amen? Dead to that old life. That old cur dog I used to be. Amen. Dead to it. Dead to it. The relationship is dead. It's broken. There's no communication. There's no relationship here no more. It's dead. That's what he's referring to, right? So if we be dead with Christ, see, this is what we're trying to get you to. The resurrection life that you desperately need, that I desperately need to enjoy and to live, is lived if we be dead with Christ. We believe we shall also live with Him. Now, it says buried with Him in baptism, wherein also you are risen with Him through the faith of the operation of God who raised Him from the dead. Paul would say it this way, 2 Timothy, it is a faithful saying, if we be dead with Him, we shall also live with Him. He's being repetitive. Paul, wherever he's going, he's talking about being dead to self. He's talking about embracing the finished work of the cross. He's talking about the sacrificial lamb and how it provides a resurrection life to you and I, a victory over sin, a liberty in Christ, grace that flows unhindered to the believer's life by proper faith in the blood sacrifice of their Savior. See, amen, amen. That's what the preaching of the cross is all about. Teaching us that old me, I'm dead to Him. Now, I'm going to take a little time here, and I feel the Lord is here with this, and I feel we're going to be okay. Now, so he's talking about this resurrection life through the cross. Amen? Through being dead to what we were. Being dead to that old man. See, when Jesus was pondering the hearts of these people. Lord, I'll follow you wherever you go. Foxes have holes, birds of the air have their nests. Son of man has no place to lay his head. He was testing them up. He was really just trying to get them to understand that, do you know the cost here? And are you willing? Are you willing to really lay it all down and follow me? See, that's what he was after. The motive of that heart. Are you really willing to lay down your life, to be dead to what you are, that I can be a resurrected life in you. See. Now, Like I said before, the resurrection life cannot be fully realized until the life is surrendered first to God's redemption plan, meaning the cross. Now, I got a question for you. There's an old cross and a new cross. This was brought up by Charles Spurgeon, I believe, in the mid-1800s. We preached on this a while back, but there's some things here I want you to see. My question to you, which cross have you been to? The one that's preached in the modern church circles, or the good old-fashioned, the good old rugged cross on a hill far away? Stood that old rugged cross. But there's a new cross that is being preached in many evangelical circles. But it's not the cross of Jesus Christ. It would be comparable to Cain's offering of the basket of what he can do to please God. And I want you to listen to this as we bring this out. You see, Abel's cross, the old cross of Calvary, the one that required he offer up the sin offering and be justified in the sight of God. And then there was Cain. Cain thought, I can change this. I don't like this sacrificial, this blood, this. I don't want nothing to do with it. I'm not that bad. I'm a pretty good guy. I work hard. I till the ground. Abel, all he does is tend sheep. That's all he does. You ever have a brother, two brothers in a family? I'm the eldest in my family. And I'm glad I got saved at the age of 25 because I was hell on earth to my siblings. Full of arrogancy, pride. Thought I was better because I was the firstborn or whatever, because I was Jeff. I was special. See, you know, they weren't, but I was. You know, I mean, you know, you laugh at that. But how many of us have had siblings? Maybe you were the bully. Maybe you oppressed your siblings. Then you'll know a little bit what I'm talking about. Maybe you're the, like Abel, you're the one that was oppressed by the boisterous, egotistical, pride-filled elder brother. Or maybe even a sister. Amen? Amen? I have a new heart now. And do you know what that new heart, within a few months, I apologize to my brothers? Amen? Hallelujah. 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 Especially my second oldest brother. Did terrible things to him. Torment him and tease him and, you know, and... I say this carefully, and I'm not saying this to be humorous, but I really feel part of his struggle with wanting God today is because some of the things I put him through. I was a bully elder brother, and it was wicked and evil, and I carry that to this day, that I feel there's things that just teasing him and being mean and cruel that I think I messed something up in him. That I've carried. I've repented of it. I've given it to God. I've repented to Him. Amen. But I pray that God will just reach down and bring him out. Amen. That he can come to know Jesus Christ. See, true preaching will just tell you the way it is. It's the way it is. It's the way we grew up. And it wasn't nice. It wasn't pretty. I needed a Savior. It took God till 25 to show me I was worthless, at least in myself. But yet God loved me. Amen. Hallelujah. Now, what cross have we been to? You see, Abel's cross, the old cross of Calvary, will point out our sin need, or our sin. It points out our sin. It deals with our sin, our condition. Amen. The cross of Jesus Christ, the true cross, will point out our sin. If you go to Cain's cross, it shows you how good you are. It tells you you're okay. You're fine. You're okay. The true cross slays me. I'm not okay. And any honest sinner will realize and acknowledge some ain't right in me. I got a sin problem. I got a sin issue. See, the old cross, it'll point it out to me. It'll show me that I'm a sinner and I need God's mercies. And that I'm lost and undone without God and His Son. Oh, Cain's altar, you go to their church, they're going to tell you just how good you are. You're okay. And when you come to God, oh, the privilege. Oh, God, glad he saved you. God can really use you in the kingdom now. You see, it puffs you up. Shows you how good you are. Says, I'm okay. But see, the old cross of Calvary requires us to die to what we are. The new cross tells you you can live your life to the full in spite of what you are. See. What a difference. You can tell by their books. Listen, we all want resurrection life. It's available to us, an abundant life. But it doesn't come until I'm dead with Christ, that He can raise me into His new life, which is an abundant life. Amen? Praise the Lord. The old cross will save you from your sin. It saves us from our sin. The new cross, they claim it saves us in our sin. It doesn't require repentance towards God. Just said, just believe. Oh, just believe. And that is a truth. We should just believe, but what are we believing? See, the new cross says that I can go on in my condition. I can add Jesus to what I am, and I can just go on, and the church tells me I'm saved because I said, well, I believe on Jesus, and He's my Lord, He's my Savior. The denominational people will tell you that. But yet trust in that sacrament for their salvation. Right? Trying to teach you something. This is more of a teaching this morning. Trying to ponder the hearts of God's people here. So that old cross will point out my sin, and it will save me from my sin. The new cross they're preaching, it'll just save you in your sin. You don't have to repent. You can be that old nasty cur dog yet. It's okay. It's not okay. It's not okay. It's not okay. Amen. Now, understandable, when I come to the cross, my sin is exposed. And He will deliver us from many things. But there can still be tentacles of things that still kind of have a little control over us. But in the work of sanctification, over time, God will liberate me from those things. You see, when I come to the true cross, I can never justify my sin. Even right now, 30-some years into the gospel, I can't justify iniquity and sin in my life. If it's wrong, it is wrong. If it's evil, it is evil. If it must be repented of and acknowledged, I must repent and acknowledge and ask God for help. Listen, I understand when we come to the Lord, some of us are, I was delivered from alcohol and profanity. But I know others, they still struggle a little bit, alcohol, still a little, once in a while, a little word that should come out of their mouth comes out. So what does that leave that person? It leaves that person in this condition. I know this isn't right, Lord, but I want deliverance. I want this out of my life. Amen? And I know you're patient and you are merciful. And through the tree, through the finished work of Calvary, you've delivered me from this bondage. And I'm believing that as I keep my faith in you, that one day, that even every time I pick up that cigarette, every time I pick up that drink, every time I slip with my tongue, every time I have that evil thought, oh God, forgive me, help me, help me, help me, help me. When you're in that spirit and condition, you've come to the real cross, and the power of that real cross will eventually bring you to the point where you're not having to repent no more of those things because God has made you free. Amen? Amen. The new cross, it just says that's okay. That's okay. You can have your wine. You can have your drink. You can swear a little bit. You can smoke and chew and run with those that do. It's all right. You can go to see any kind of filthy, abominable movie you want. It's all right. You can listen to any kind of queer, jaded, twisted, perverted music you want. Oh, that's okay. That's okay. God loves you. God loves you. See, that's that new cross. But the old cross deals with the heart. It deals with Adam. It deals with the old me. And it says, no, that is not acceptable in the eyes of God. See. Hallelujah. He's a deliverer. He will ever be our deliverer. Amen. That anger problem, that lust problem, that greed problem, that pride problem, that's all iniquity that God and the cross, the true cross, will deal with that and not allow me to make excuse for it. Well, it's just the way I am. Didn't we just say if you're dead with him? That means that, oh, the way I am, it's supposed to be dead. It's supposed to have died. That person in Christ doesn't exist no more. No more excuses. Well, that's just the way I am. No. You are a new creation in Jesus Christ. That old you has passed away, and now everything has become new. And everything is of God. And that's why the conflict is there. Wow. See, when I try to make excuse to live my old life, you know, listen to radio and an old song will come on. Song that you used to like in the world. And in all honesty, when you hear that song, there's something in you. That was a good old song back then, you know. And then you try to entertain that a little bit, and all of a sudden you start feeling like a dog. So what's wrong with me? I remember what life was like when I liked that song, and it wasn't too good. I'm a new creation in Jesus Christ. I listen to God's music now, amen, and it builds me, amen. Hallelujah. Doesn't mean you don't have propensity towards that old. But it tells you that through the cross there is a victory. Oh, I got to get through this really quick. I don't want to keep you too long here. Amen. So, the old cross. Which cross have we been to? The old cross of Calvary will slay Adam. In the new cross, it'll reform Adam and redirect him. It tries to put perfume, a little bit of sweet smell, on a dead body. Amen. You can't do that. You can't do that. You can't modify and redirect that old nature, that old man. You can't rehabilitate him. He must die in the true cross and be put to death with Christ. And God brings up a new man now and starts working in that new man. That new person in you, who is Christ in you now, he takes up the throne of your life and he starts cleaning house year after year, and he's gracious. But he's cleaning your house, the house of your heart, the house of your spirit, and he's graceful and he's gentle with you unless you really step over that line, and that lamb will all of a sudden be a lion and will bear down on you and let you know this isn't right, because he's jealous over you. The old cross will slay Adam. The new one, oh, that's fine. We'll just rehabilitate you. We'll get you on that psychiatric couch and we'll just talk to you about all your problems. And you can't talk termites out of wood, my friend. The problem is your wood is infested with termites. You can't talk the termites out of the wood. There's only one cure for the termites: the blood of Jesus Christ applied to the doorpost of your heart. Amen. The old cross, that world becomes my enemy because I'm a child of God. I march to the beat of a different drum now. I'm following righteousness and purity and holiness. Amen. That's my pursuit, because that's who he is, right? That new cross, the world's really your friend. Well, how do you know, Pastor? Because they'll turn you to the help of that world every time you got a problem too big for them. Amen. Listen, I understand. Listen, We're not saying you bury your head in the sand. If you break your arm, don't go to the hospital. That's in the world. And that you ain't spiritual. You should pray over that broken arm and see if God will heal it. You know. Well, I would pray over my broken arm. We do pray over those things. But what he's talking about isn't you got to work your job in a fallen world. You got to get sick. You got to go to the doctor. He's not talking about that. The new cross basically says the help you need in your spirit to overcome sin issues, oh, we can help you with that. We'll just numb you down with some medications. We'll just send you at $200 an hour to a family counselor who will help try to get all those termites out of your wood by talking to them. We'll go to the world's way in the world's system of help instead of leaning on the Lord. Oh, we could spend an hour on that, but I just want to get through this very quickly today. You see, the true cross dealt with every need you and I will ever have. Jesus Christ dealt with every need you and I in this life will ever have. Hello? Every need of your spirit, your heart, your life, your provision, the clothes you're wearing, every single need has been dealt with at the true cross. But if you go to the new cross, it'll promote self-help and philosophy. The old cross will justify you in the eyes of God. The new cross will leave you dead in your sins, and not only that, but it will leave you as an enemy of God. Amen? It will leave you as an enemy of God. Which cross have you been to? Which cross are you embracing? Which one are you picking up every day and following the one you're telling me you love? Which cross? Which cross? A little further. The old cross will sanctify me by daily grace and the inner working of the Holy Spirit. The new cross will sanctify my life by my own self-efforts and self-help philosophies. The old cross will point to the prosperity of the next world. The new cross focuses on the prosperity of this world and this life for the most part only. The old cross will provide unity by truth of Jesus Christ and Him crucified for us. The new cross promotes unity by ecumenical compromise. You know, they attack us for being narrow-minded. Let them attack because we're still right. We're still right. We're still right. We can't unify with people that are of mixed faiths. The Chrislam movement now trying to find common ground with Christianity, common ground with Islam, and trying to merge where we're at least agreeing on a few little things and call it, oh, look at this unity. Isn't that sweet? Isn't that wonderful? It's a stench in the nostrils of God. Amen? And it's not of God. The old cross will provide the fivefold ministry to build and equip the saints. The new cross will promote the fivefold ministry to rule and reign over people. To somehow control you. Because they're the apostles. They're the prophet. Car carrying. They are over you. And their favorite scriptures out of Hebrews, obey those that have the rule over you. Which is me. Can't you tell? See. See. Obey those. Obey those. That's the only... You know, the world, there's one scripture the world knows, judge not. And there's only one scripture the false teachers know. Obey. Hallelujah. Obey those that have the rule over you. Been there, done that, been through it, bought the t-shirt, have the card, cut the card up, got rid of it, found the truth in Jesus Christ, got to the right cross, and everything changed. Amen. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Almost finished. That old cross will open your eyes to the false. One of the earmarks that I've learned about the message of the cross, when you're understanding it, and God has given you the revelation of how you take up that cross, how you find that victory, it comes very clear, very quick, to those that are not promoting and preaching the proper gospel. Within 2-3 seconds, you can discern something isn't right. You're either preaching Jesus and His finished work to the people, or you're preaching submission to men and religious authority. There's only two camps. There's only two camps. Peter said it this way: they promise them liberty, they have great swelling words. Oh, they promise them great things. Oh, they'll give you the abundant life. But if you're at that new cross, all they can do is clothe you with a system. The old cross, the true system, gets in your spirit and in your heart. It gets in you. Amen. That's why Johnny don't come to church where they preach the gospel. That's why Susie don't come to church where they preach the gospel. They want to live in their sin and feel comfortable in their sin and not feel guilt. And they don't want to surrender. They're just like these people Jesus is talking about in our text. Oh yeah, I'll follow you. I'll go to church. I'll go to your church, Jesus. I will. So you're going to take up your cross? Which one? I like the one where they tell me how good I am. I like the one where they tell me I'm going to just be rich and have everything I need and just want. And oh, you know, there's no demand on my part. I can smoke and drink and run with those that do. And I can chew and I can curse and cuss and everything else. And everything's all right. Oh, I like that church. That ain't no church. That's no cathedral. That's not even a sanctuary of God. That is where human beings are dumbed down and brainwashed and taught to believe a lie. And their life will never change. Amen. Hallelujah. Oh, I've been preaching too long. Abel's cross, the old cross, it offends. The new cross is seeker sensitive. The old cross is bloody. It's unattractive. It's repulsive to man. That's why when Jesus said, "Lest ye eat of my flesh, drink of my blood," it said many went back from him that and followed him no more. Jesus' disciples even told him, "Jesus, can you clarify that? These people are leaving." And he said, "Are you going away also?" He says, "Listen, the words I'm talking about, they are spirit and they are life." In other words, if they're not getting the understanding, the revelation of my shed blood for them, there's no life in them anyway. Because their heart is not ready for that yet. See, and the old cross brings believers into true fellowship with God when it's believed upon right. You will walk with Him. You will talk with Him. You will have fellowship with the living God through Jesus Christ. You will have an abundant life at your disposal. You will start manifesting the fruit of the Spirit. You will have joy unspeakable and full of glory from a new heart, amen, and a new spirit that He has put in you. You will have all the benefits for which Christ died. But you see, the new cross, it's bloodless. Outwardly, it's beautiful. Amen. But I'm here to say, even though the real cross is bloody, unattractive, and repulsive, I'm here to say it's beautiful to God. And it's beautiful to you that is embraced by faith Jesus and Him crucified for me. Amen. One more thing here. In a sense, when you come to the true cross, you become the living dead. Isn't there a movie out there called The Living Dead or something like that? I'm alive, but I'm dead. I'm dead to that old me, but I'm alive in God. I'm the living dead. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. But that new cross, and I scribbled this down this morning because I was pondering that a little bit. But the new cross, we remain dead in our sins while we live. Amen. In Christ, I'm the living dead. But in the new cross, I'm dead while I live. meaning no hope of eternity, no hope of life outside of this life, because I'm yet dead in my sins. I could go on another hour, but I don't think you can handle it, and I think we're finished today, but I'm going to ask musicians to come. But I'm here to say, what cross have you been to? What cross have you favored? What cross have you picked up daily, and which one are you following him every day? The cross of old, of Abel, or the cross of Cain, the new cross that's preached today? You can't have both. And I'm asking all of us to make that decision today. Make it clear. Make it clear with God. Make it clear with yourself. Draw a line in the sand. You say, I may not understand that old cross, how it all works. Pastor's always preaching about it. When I read the Bible, I see Paul's always talking about it. The disciples are always talking about it. But I ask you, what cross are you embracing? Because it will prove itself by the grace that you are living in right now. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, at the cross, where I first saw the light, and the burdens of my heart, he rolled away. Oh, it was there by faith I receive my sight, and now I am happy all the day. Alas, indeed, my Savior bleed, and did my sovereign die? Would he devote that sacred head for such a worm as I? Sing it with me. At the cross, where I first saw the light, and the burdens of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the Let's stand this morning. Amen. Let's just stand to our feet. Hallelujah. Ask the eldership to come up, please. And if you have a prayer need this morning, maybe you're still wrestling with this message. You know, Pastor, you preach this, but I just don't know if I'm comprehending where you're going with that message. Paul said that he prayed for the church, that God would open up their inner understanding, that God would enlighten them, that they would see what the great hope of this calling is all about. The cross is a revelation. It's a revelation of a truth. It's a revelation of what Jesus Christ has done for you personally by hanging on the tree in your place. He not only provided your eternity, but he gave you benefits that you can war good warfare in this life and have an abundant life and have resurrection life to the full. Amen. Oh, there will be problems and troubles and tribulation and situations, but he has promised. If you're embracing him properly, he will give you grace to endure and to come through whatever life hurls at you. Amen. For all things work together for good to them that love God and are the called according to his